Friends, this is the continued part of rectilinear propagation of light. So in the previous video we come to know that area of each half period zone is equal to pi b lambda, and for all the half period zones it is constant. So what are half period zones? Already this has been discussed. At every crest and trough, if you draw the zones, then those are called as half period zones. Why half? Means the time period of each zone will be equal to t by 2. At every t by 2 time interval, so we are going to draw the zones. Or else in terms of distance, if you want to define, means at every alternate crest and trough you are going to get the distance lambda by 2. So that's why this is half period zones, and these zones are called as Fresnel's half period zones. So all these zones are having the same area, that is equal to pi b lambda, and the radius of first, second, third half period zones are equal to root of 1 b lambda, root of 2 b lambda, root of 3 b lambda, and so on. So where b and lambda are constants, b is the distance from the center of the wavefront to the screen or point where the intensity is to be calculated, and then this lambda is the wavelength of light used. So if these two being constant, means the radius of half period zone, this varies directly as roots of the natural numbers. So all these terms we have discussed. So now we'll continue with this. So look at the diagram here. So here m1, m2, m3, m4, m5, m6, and this continues. So these represent the intensity of the, not intensity, these are the amplitudes of vibration of medium particles. So first half period zone is there. So what are the particles that lie in the first half period zone? They are having, or they are vibrating with the amplitude m1. m2 is the second half period zone. m3 is the amplitude of the particles which are there in the third half period zone, and this continues. So as in the Fresnel's assumptions, it has been already told that as the obliquity factor increases, the quantities, means the amplitudes of vibration of the particle m1, m2, etc. are continuously decreases. As the obliquity factor increases, the amplitudes of vibration of the particles, medium particles which lie in that particular zone period, half period zone, so they are going to decrease. So here m1 is the intensity or amplitude of the ether particles or medium particles which are there in the first half period zone. So these will be having the maximum amplitude. Why? Because the obliquity factor for this will be minimum, or else you can call this as zero. Then the intensity gradually, as you move outward from the central point, that is from the point O, so this obliquity factor increases, so the amplitude of vibration of the particles, that is going to decrease. So m1 is greater than m2, m2 is greater than m3. So as you move outward from the center point O, the intensity or amplitude of the medium particles, that is continuously decreases. And one more thing, so here the direction continuously for one half period zone to next half period zone, that is decreasing. So look at the diagram here. This is the propagation of direction of propagation of wave. So here to here, this is called as crest, and this is called as trough. So in the crest, the medium particles are there, they are vibrating in one direction, and in the trough, the medium particles are vibrating in the opposite direction. So these two are vibrating in opposite direction. So all the crest will be in one direction, the particles which are vibrating in the crest will be in one direction, and next in the trough they will be in the opposite direction to the crest particles. So that is what shown in the diagram. So here m1 is there. This is the first half period zone. This is regarded with the first half period zone. In the first half period zone, for the crest, here we have constructed the zone. means the particles will be vibrating in the upward direction. Next, in the trough, next half period zone is constructed. So here in this region, the particles are vibrating in the downward opposite direction. Next, again crest will be there. For the crest, third half period zone we are going to get, and that will be there in the upward direction. So this is M3, M4, M5, and this continues. So here is a consideration. What we are going to consider is the amplitude of vibration of particles at point P due to any zone can be approximately taken as mean of amplitudes due to the zone preceding and succeeding it. Let us suppose here M1 is there. This is the amplitude of vibration that is coming from the first half period zone, and this is amplitude of vibration from the second half period zone, and this is from the third half period zone. So at point P, let us suppose here is point P. At point P, the amplitude of vibration of any half period zone that can be approximately taken as mean of amplitudes of zone preceding it and succeeding it. Let us suppose at point P, what is the contribution of the second half period zone, and the amplitude corresponding to the second half period zone can be written as M2. So at point P, the contribution from the second half period zone is M2, and this can be approximately written as the amplitude of the zone preceding it. Preceding means M1 will be there, succeeding it means M3 will be there. Mean of amplitudes of the zones preceding it and succeeding it. So here this I am going to write as M1 plus M3 divided by 2. Mean, this is the mean of zone preceding it means M1, succeeding it means M3, and the mean of that gives M1 plus M3 divided by 2. In the similar manner for all the half period zones, we can extend this. So here the resultant amplitude at any point due to all the half period zones can be written as the resultant amplitude I will represent as A. At point P, due to all the half period zones, can be written as M1 is the intensity that is coming from the first half period zone. So all these are in the positive direction. So for all the odd number of half period zones, the amplitude I am going to represent by the plus sign, and for all the even number of half period zones, they will be there in the opposite direction, that I will represent in the minus sign. So this will be M1 minus M2 plus M3 minus M4 plus so on. Here plus MN you are going to get when n is odd. So plus MN will be there when N is odd, means the last half period zone is odd half period zone. Then this at last you are going to get plus MN, and if this continues, minus MN you are going to get when N is even. So at last, if the even half period zone is there, then the resultant amplitude will be A is equal to M1 minus M2 plus M3, and this so on. Minus MN will be there if it ends with the even number of half period zone. Then from this consideration, the resultant amplitude what I am going to write is A is equal to, so this M1 is there, M1 term, this I can write as M1 by 2 plus M1 by 2. So M1 I am going to write as M1 by 2 plus M1 by 2, which is nothing but M1 only. I will put a bracket here, and the M2 term I will keep as it is, minus M2 as it is. Next, this M3 again I will write as M3 by 2 plus M3 by 2. So one term I will write in the bracket, M3 by 2, one will be there in the bracket, and the remaining term I will take to the next bracket. So the here will be M3 by 2, and this minus M4 I will write as it is. Then again next term comes M5 that m5 I will write as again m5 by 2 plus m5 by 2 and this continues. Okay, in the bracket 1 m5 by 2 will be there and the remaining term will be as it is and this continues. But here we know that according to the consideration m2 is equal to m1 by 2 plus this m3 by 2 and m4 is equal to m3 by 2 plus m5 by 2. Here the values of m2 and m4 I am going to substitute in the above equation. So if we substitute for m2 and for m4, so this bracket term becomes equal to 0 because m1 by 2 here minus m1 by 2 that becomes 0 and minus m3 by 2 plus m3 by 2 that also becomes 0 and this continue all the bracket terms becomes equal to 0 and at last what you are going to left with is the resultant amplitude at any point P due to all the half period zones is equal to this first term will be there, this is m1 by 2 and the last term will be remaining, that is mn by 2 plus mn by 2 you are going to get if n is odd. If the last half period zone is odd half period zone then plus mn by 2 you are going to get. So this a is equal to m1 by 2 plus mn by 2. If n is even then this will be m1 by 2 plus mn minus 1 divided by, this is the term previous to the last term, plus mn minus 1 divided by 2 and the last term will be there, that is minus mn, this is you are left with. So minus mn will be there if n is even. If m n is even then the resultant amplitude you are going to get with is m1 by 2 plus mn minus 1 by 2 minus mn. So now the amplitudes are continuously of decreasing order. Why? Because the obliquity factor is continuously increasing. So the amplitudes are continuously decreasing order means this mn term and mn minus 1 term, so all these terms tends to 0. So as the number of half period zones increases, as n tends to infinity, the mn and mn minus 1 term, these tends to 0. Why? Because the amplitude continuously decreases. Therefore, so these last terms are there, they tends to 0. You are left with only the first term, that is m1 by 2. Hence, the resultant amplitude A is equal to m1 by 2. So this is the amplitude. Then if I extend this for the intensity, we know that intensity is directly proportional to square of the amplitude. So this term I am going to write as I is proportional to amplitude is m1 by 2 and the square of this is m1 square divided by 4 you are going to get. That is the intensity at any point is directly proportional to m1 square, where m1 is the amplitude of the particles which are coming from the first half period zone. Thus what this represents is the intensity at any point P is only 1/4 of that due to the first half period zone alone. Here only the area of the first half period zone is effective in producing the illumination at point P. If in the place of this first half period zone any obstacle if you place, means the area of the half period zone if you cover by any obstacle, means the resultant effect at point P, that will be 0 because the resultant intensity at any point P that depends only on the first half period zone. If you cover the first half period zone, means the intensity or illumination at point P because of rest of the half period zone, that will be zero. So that is what this represents. Thus, while considering the rectilinear propagation of light, the size of the obstacle used is far greater than the area of the first half period zone, and hence the bending effect of light around the edge of the obstacle cannot be noticed. If the size of the obstacle placed in the path of the light is comparable to the wavelength of light, then it is possible to observe the illumination in the region of geometrical shadow. Thus, rectilinear propagation of light is only approximately true. So here completes this. Thank you.